Whoa, James, that's fairly dizzying. Let me see. You're talking about how everything we do is conditioned by our values, and you're talking about change and innovation. I understand all of that. But what are you getting at in that NORAD sequence?
Well, there are a couple of reasons why we went in that very important hole under the ground. One is that it's a television program, and that may be why it's dizzying, because you're thinking with your professorial hat on, I feel. We could argue about that later, but we go into NORAD because it's an exciting place to go. These first programs in major series tend to be less exciting than all the other programs because they're busy setting out the ground rules. And so one wants to try and zip it up a bit. So when we got the chance to go to NORAD, we went. And also because NORAD, this series I hope will turn out to be an enjoyable trap. NORAD is bait. With NORAD, I'm saying there is something about the way we view the world and the way we decide to protect ourselves to this tremendous extent, about which interesting things will be said later on and about which you, the viewer, will discover as the series progresses. So NORAD is bait, and it isn't what it appears to be. And if I tell you any more than that, I'll spoil the rest of the series.
Okay, I'll wait to find out the rest of the answer. Let me ask you about the lock that you put down in front of the camera, in front of the viewer, and you say you want to know what this is, don't you? You tantalize us with an initial view. Wouldn't a person from any culture on the globe be equally fascinated, equally curious?
Yeah, they'd pick it up and they'd say, yes, oh, what's this? And then when they discovered it, they'd probably put it down. I mean, we are curious and dynamic with our curiosity in the West. What I'm trying to say in that program, I hope, and in the rest of the series, is that where others will pick it up and say yes and put it down again, we will pick it up and say, oh, what's this? And then say, how can I use it? The world, after all, today, is a world that runs on Western technology and Western science in the main, and that's a fact that we can't alter.
One of the things that dizzied me, despite my tendency to be professorial, one of the things that dizzied me was a sort of pinball style of intellectual history, caroming off one thing, bouncing to another. And I gather this may partly be simply to find fresh paths over well-trodden terrain, but is it also out of some sort of distrust of a linear approach that feeds into orthodoxy?
Yes, although I wouldn't put it in that rather serious way. But yes, and it's what the series again relates to, will relate to, that those linear views that we adopt, that we are taught in school about history, and after all, what I'm talking about is history. Those linear views select history and put it into boxes that I, for one, don't really believe happened. I believe history happened the way things happen today. They happen this way. And the pinball effect that you call it, A, I think is as valid an approach to the way things happen in history, and B, certainly much more interesting in terms of a television viewer. And after all, what am I trying to do? I'm trying to tell people things that they didn't know before, and I'm trying to tell them things that maybe they didn't want to know before, or thought they weren't intelligent enough to understand before, or thought they were too polysyllabic and too important for them to know, and enjoy the process. And therefore, what I'm looking for at all times is a way of making new and interesting and sometimes oblique approaches to the knowledge that our educational systems tend to tell us should really only belong to people who are very intelligent and very good at passing exams and end up with PhDs. This is not true. Everybody, it seems to me, enjoys the experience of learning and becoming a more active, more dynamic person as a result of being able to act on their own lives with more decisiveness to more satisfactory ends.
And we so, both seek and resist innovation in this fashion that you describe.
Yes, we do, but what I'm trying to do is to say, before you resist it, seek it. What I'm trying to do with this pinball effect is to make the process of learning through these programs, above all, exhilarating.
Right, I like that program, and I understand it's about how we in the West lost our inquiring spirit sometime in the late 5th century and found it again over the next 900 years. But what really intrigues me is the way you use that image of the stoplight in the desert at the beginning and again at the end of the program. It's a very potent symbol.
Well, it's a television program, and television programs need potent symbols. It works at various levels. As I hope the series does. I hope people can extract different things at different levels from the series. It It reminds that light is the thing that Theodoric decides to investigate. It reminds that there is divine illumination, you know, the illumination of knowledge, the end of the dark ages, light dawns, the light of reason. All those images are in there in that stoplight.
I guess, too, it also represents law and obedience to it, and even patent law,
yes,
which encourages innovation or, yes, enables someone to exploit it.
And the other thing, which maybe not many people will want to get is that it reminds people of the red light district in which Augustine lived before he became a bishop.
I know he talks about that in his confessions. There is a sense, too, in which the driver looks forward and not backward. As you say, in the dark ages, everything everyone knew was old. The role of the church in the course of this program is paradoxical, isn't it?
Well, it appears to be paradoxical, but I mean, if you look at what happens, if it weren't for Augustine saying, take yourselves off to these monasteries, what little they knew would not have survived. And at the same time, while he is saying, turn your back on the real world as giving you the fundamental truth about everything, because it's worthless. At the same time, he also says, you know, that nature is a great book written by God and that you should read the book written by God. So at the same time as denying the fact that we can know anything, as it were, final on earth, he doesn't say don't look. So he does continue. After all, Theodoric is a cleric.
Your contrast between the barbarians of Northern Europe and the civilized Moors of Spain, that's very striking. But if Arab culture was so sophisticated, why did it lose its luster?
Because we barbarians destroyed it, in simple terms. We found a civilization that provided, I think, for the last time for many centuries, a reasonable, sane, and above all, tolerant society in which to live. Much of what the Arabs did to preserve Greek science and have it there for us when we turned up in Toledo and other places, they were only able to do that thanks to the fact that they were able to use scholars who were Jews and Christians. At that time, everybody else was giving these people a very hard time. Those people, Jews and Christians, lived happily and contentedly and profitably among the Arabs of the period, who were intensely tolerant in their view of other religions. It was we who went along and later on taught intolerance and anti-Semitism, not the Arabs.
I began to perceive something that had eluded me, that in a way the series is quite possibly a plea for tolerance, an effort to resist a hardening of the orthodoxies.
Yes, I mean, I couldn't put it quite that way. But essentially, I think what the series will reveal as we go on through it is that certainty is a kind of prison, that when you're absolutely certain, you're also possibly absolutely blind, and that that's no way to find your way forward or backwards or sideways or indeed anywhere, because you don't know where you're going.
Was there really a stoplight in the middle of the desert?
No.
And did you have to hire the camels?
Well, no, the Tunisians wouldn't let us put a stoplight in the desert because they said we couldn't remove it from where it was standing in Tunisia. So we imported one, which took some considerable difficulties.
And did you hire the camels?
No, they were walking by at the time. And they fitted perfectly, serendipitous.
How astonishing. One of the things I wanted to ask. Okay, right. We have to know where we are and where we're going in order to have the confidence to venture into new places. I get that. The thing that sticks in my imagination is the moment when Toscanelli takes his flat map and bends it back into a cylinder. Because in the popular imagination, before Columbus proved otherwise, everybody thought the world was flat.
Yes, I know that's a popular belief, but it wasn't held by the people who were actually sailing the seas, or indeed by the astronomers or the mathematicians. As it happens, the same year Columbus discovered America, the very first globe was produced in Germany. So that's how much they knew it was round. And in fact, they had known since the ancient Greeks. Aristotle said, look at the shadow on the moon. It's got to be a spherical Earth. And then the geographer who wrote in Roman times, Strabo, his texts were rediscovered at the beginning of the century in which Columbus went to America. So Columbus probably knew all his life that the Earth was round, as did all the people who mattered. So Toscanelli's idea wasn't all that new. What he was saying was, it's a short way across, and there's nothing in the way, which is, of course, where he made his big mistake.
This Toscanelli must have been quite a guy anyhow, though. I mean, after all, he was a man who made connections between Ptolemy and Alhazen, Brunelleschi and Columbus, perspective painting and gridded cartography.
He knew the people who mattered, yes. Well, he'd been to school with most of them. The great thing about Toscanelli, of course, was that he was highly motivated because his family were in the spice trade business, and one of the reasons he was keen to get them round Africa and off to the Spice Islands was, I presume, because he wanted to continue, his family business wanted to continue to make money.
But look at people like the Vikings and the Polynesians. They may have been marauders and freebooters, but they achieved astounding navigational feats.
The big difference is the grids. With a grid, you can go, and it doesn't matter what the current is, or what the wind is, or what the star is, you can measure where you are in time and space. As a matter of fact, the Portuguese, for a long time before Columbus did what he did, were out deep into the South Atlantic carrying out secret military exercises using this new secret weapon, the grid, and discovering that they could indeed go from A to B without knowing where either A or B were. And as a matter of fact, ultimately, that's how Brazil was discovered. One of them went too far, was blown too far off course, and came back saying, hey, there's a new continent down there.
The Polynesians, though they didn't write it down, when they sailed across the trackless waste, communicated via
their Maori dances.
The hula dances, yes. Which indicated how far you sail and where you turn.
Indeed.
But of course, because it wasn't written down, it wasn't available, it wasn't shared.
No, they didn't grid themselves.
You talk about the catch-22. In gridding the world, we also grid ourselves. We expose ourselves to surveillance, state control.
That is a sort of recurring theme throughout the series, that we make decisions about the science and technology we want, and we make them in very contemporary circumstances. We make them within a sort of conceptual box that we live in, and when we've made our step, we say, that's good, it solved our problem. But we don't know at the time, often, or we don't think enough at the time, about the fact that in creating an answer, we also create another question. And that, in this sense, science and technology is a double-edged weapon. And like, as you say, gridding the world, we grid ourselves. This series is seeded with examples of that. I hope to show, ultimately, in the 10th program, that it's this lack of concern beyond your own immediate needs that piles up the problems. And ultimately, that's really what the series is about.
Well, that's fascinating. So, our real subject is data access, information access, and the revolution caused by printing. The day the universe changed always has social consequences. In what ways was authority undermined by this revolution?
One of the things I would really have liked to have had more time to emphasize in that program was the fact that that was the beginning of our modern love of youth with books. Young people didn't have to go to old people to learn things anymore. They just had to read the books they wrote. The change was tremendous. I mean, almost immediately people were saying, we do not need the authority of our elders. Villages, the whole sort of nuclear village broke apart because of this, because young people started to say, I don't need to respect you for your memory anymore because I've got a potted memory here in this book. So that's one of the prime changes, I think, that happened.
It's fascinating to me, too, that visualization was as revolutionary, perhaps more so than verbalization in printed texts. All these woodcuts in the new books.
The strange thing is it had a sort of double effect because while on the one hand it encouraged standardization of fact because you could draw those pictures of the flowers and say that's not right because I can look at a real flower, it had the opposite effect in a sense with the Protestant Reformation because they said instead of having all those churches with statues and stories in stone and glass for the illiterate, we'll teach them to read, and then we won't need all that idolatry, if you like. And that's basically why the nonconformist churches ended up very plain and simple, because they taught people to read, and then they didn't need those pictures on the walls.
Is it really true that it was Gutenberg himself who made a mistake in man's anticipating the need for indulgences in Aachen?
Well, I believe so. From what I've read, they were going to this pilgrim's fair, and because there were no almanacs, and standardized times and standardized agreed dates other than those of, you know, the saints' days, and you relied on people's memories about what day it was, he got to the fair the right day, but the wrong year. And since they had invested so much, he'd borrowed so much money, they were in real trouble, and he had to think up something very quick to get himself out of the trouble, which in a sense was created by the fact that there weren't printed books. So it's a nice, neat circle there.
In your own visualization, television visualization, at the very end, you introduced the computer. And of course, in terms of information access, if indexing and cross-indexing were revolutionary, the computer is even more so in extending access to information and or knowledge. Mm. You imply that we might confront a revolution in our society comparable to that which printing...
I think infinitely greater. I think we're about to bump up against a revolution that's going to make what Gutenberg did look like, you know, a quiet afternoon stroll. The interesting thing is, and I hope to show this later on in the series, the possibility that what the electronics revolution will do to us will be to, as it were, give us back what Gutenberg took away, not our memories, because we will need them even less, I think, but that nuclear village I talked about, which had been destroyed. I think electronics may send us back to the village, but as we live in our little electronic villages, with telecommuting possible so we don't have to go into cities to work, we will be living once more as we lived before print in close personal contact. But because of the electronic revolution, we may well be able to, at the same time, live that intensely interactive community life in a small village from which we are, as it were, thrown out by Gutenberg, but at the same time have the data of the world available at our fingertips while we do so.
Well, it's fascinating to analyze the image. So let's see, Copernicus replaces Aristotle, and Newton creates a mechanical universe obedient to universal laws, and at every step, the church seems to object. Are we talking about science versus religion?
No, because the church essentially there doesn't object. When I said the church went over backwards to help Galileo, they did. I mean, it's a myth that's grown up in the intervening centuries. The cardinal in charge wrote to Galileo several times saying, our astronomers agree with you. We know that what you're trying to say, we know what you say about these observed facts is true, but you've got to go slowly. You've got to give us time. You can't just tell the believers that everything they believe is apparently wrong. And Galileo said, no, all or nothing. I mean, so they bent over. The other criticism for what was going on came, for example, from government sources too. The French, who made life hot for Descartes, also threw out the Jesuits. So it isn't just, it's authority saying, hold on, don't crack the mold so that everything falls apart. Take things sensibly and reasonably. That's their view, of course.
One of the things I've noticed is you have a sort of Buster Keaton approach to history in which the little man, especially when he's up against the big institution, is often the champion, and that translates sometimes into the practical man versus the theoretical professor, so that yes. Barrel makers, boat builders, artillerymen, yes, often come up with answers that elude the philosophers.
I don't know that they come up with the answers. I think there's a case for arguing that sometimes they rub their noses in it, as it were. They say, it's no use telling us that physics doesn't describe real things. Look what this cannonball is doing. Is this Scotch mist, they say, you know. No. So they're hitting reality, as it were, practically all the time, as opposed to the philosophers who say these are just lines in the sky.
There's practical TV, too. And I am intrigued by the way in which your television programs are put together. A stone is thrown in the present, it falls into the past. Galileo drops a ball with a spiral pattern, and you're holding it in the contemporary world in an Italian square.
Yeah, well, I mean, you've got to keep the audience interested all the time, haven't you? So we need all these devices. One of the things that I like to do is to take the program, and I think it's ready, before we shoot it, and graph out how difficult is it? Or it's, you know, difficult, not so difficult, medium, very difficult, and then impose on top of that, how busy is it? How much distraction is there, noise and so on? And put that graph on. How How relaxed is it? What pauses of silence? Are there moments when the audience can relax and enjoy and think about what they've just seen? And very often, the sad thing is that you see all the bits you like most in the programmes are, you know, busy and difficult and funny and noisy, and then you have to go and shift stuff around a bit, and that's when all these devices come into being.
You like to start and stop in the same place. That is, you pose a sort of an intriguing question, what am I doing here in the beginning? You start at Schönbrunn.
In Vienna,
because I guess their plans were being made for the Council of Trent.
The original plans were being made there, and then your problem is to find a reason to go back. I like to do that because it closes the circle in a program and it makes people feel as if they've seen something complete. It took a long time to find a reason to go back to Vienna. Lots of times I thought I was going to have to abandon beginning in Vienna and start somewhere else, but every time I tried to start in somewhere else, I couldn't find an end for that either. And then fortunately, going on beyond Newton to Halley, I discovered the importance of Boscovich, who happened to be there at the time, and the circle was complete.
It works very ingeniously, I think. Credit where it's due. Obviously, that's a pun. The program title, like many of the other program titles, has at least, well, two puns, credit and due.
Yes. Well, yes, that's true. Credit because of, obviously, the financial revolution that we're talking about that made all these things happen, because it released the cash and made it flow around the country. And due because this is an approach to the reasons why it happened, which I found very attractive and which is historically okay, valid, and it's not the one that I think most people are told. The idea that the dissenters were so key, the nonconformists were so key to what happened, and in a sense, therefore, they get the credit that they've been due all along, but which most people didn't know about.
Do you have percentages on the number of dissenters who actually...
Yeah, it's interesting, the dissenter business, because a survey taken shows that 50% of the entrepreneurs at the time were dissenter, and the dissenters formed only 3% of the population. So that gives you the idea of the kind of influence they were having.
What about the human cost of the Industrial Revolution, especially in those transitional generations? Were the workers really better off than they had been in the countryside?
Well, everybody still argues that. I mean, there's no doubt that the conditions in the cities were appalling. I mean, people were coming in to live in conditions that were absolutely incomprehensibly dreadful to us. One of the problems about shooting that stuff is, how do you recreate the filth and the squalor and the degradation? You can't. On the other hand, they didn't go back to the villages when there were temporary times of depression. And one of the interesting things about that is that perhaps it's a little bit like some of the immigrants who came here in the 19th century, that, you know, they came and they worked perhaps in terribly bad conditions in various parts of the major cities in the United States, but anything was better to what, you know, to compare with what they'd left. And if you look at what they left, it was, as I said in the film, far from being a lovely bucolic a dream that they kept. Those places were really repressive, those villages.
Some of the mills were better than others. I saw in the credits you mentioned New Lanark. Did you actually shoot at Robert Owen's model?
Yes, that mill where I talked about people who'd never known anything about time, that was supposed to be a utopian mill set up by an early socialist on a kind of workers' cooperative basis. And, you know, that was the best it was going to be by a long way. And then that didn't work either.
I guess the revolutionary aspect of the Industrial Revolution is that it literally changed the space and time we inhabit in our daily lives.
It's very difficult to realize for us that almost everything we consider to be time, the division of the day, having holidays, the idea that you work for wages, a salary, a credit base, all these things didn't happen until the Industrial Revolution. And before then, people lived in a kind of time warp. There was no sense of time. There was no sense of having to finish jobs by a certain date. You were entirely at the whim of nature. You had no control over it.
And the very sense of punctuality was created by the clock, and since the clock controlled the schedule in the new industrialized plants, I suppose the kind of time according to which one regulates...
Yes, everything becomes regimented and everything becomes standard. And when you get standardized parts, then the things people have also become standard and life becomes homogenized. I mean, the Industrial Revolution and the ability of factories to turn out parts that were the same ends in our modern world, where we have bite-sized television news, newspapers that tell you this much neatly packaged about everything, so that everybody gets the same thing and they don't have to make too much effort to get either more or less of it. They simply get nice prepackaged bits that's what our life is like due to this basic approach that all, a sort of democracy of possessions. Everybody would have the same things, so everybody would be equal in a sense.
That was very nice. Okay, the revolution here is the application of statistics to human beings. But what interests me is that post-revolutionary France should have been to so great an extent the center of medical advances. That's very clear in your book. Louis Pasteur is mentioned prominently there, and even William Farr studied
William Farr
in Paris
in France,
for several years. Why was it that France was so important a center in this respect? It was obviously due to something more than an abundance of corpses.
Well, yeah, that was pretty important, though. I mean, to do studies quite as extensive as that, you had to have lots of bodies, live and dead. One of the reasons, I think, most people agree, was that at the time, in that century, it was very popular to think in terms of numbers, the size of the population being vital to the power and wealth of the country, so much so that some countries kept their population statistics secret, however crudely collected they had been. So numbers were important. Then one must realize that the French Revolution was something absolutely unheard of. I mean, they took a king and got rid of him, and then they chopped off aristocrats' heads with impunity. This was absolutely appalling, and that's why as soon as it happened, almost everybody else in Europe jumped on the French. I mean, they were attacked on all sides by the major powers. So the matter of having enough men in a healthy enough state to defend the country became also of paramount importance. So I think there was a bit of a vested interest there in concentrating quite so much on the health of the nation, being able to defend the nation, really, in a sense.
You do talk at the end about the social consequences of this revolution, of the application of statistics to human beings. Could you say something more about that?
Well, I think what comes out of it, at least what I hope came out of the series there, the program there, was that in the modern world, the coming together of statistics and medicine creates a situation where there is a sort of accepted norm, social norm, and if you depart from it, there's something wrong with you. But it's not something wrong with society or the community, it's something wrong with you. We have isolated disease, we've fragmented and dissected the matter of disease in human beings to the extent that when something is wrong with you, we cure the bug. If it is a psychiatric illness, we treat it like a physical disease. In Russia, dissidents are called people who need psychiatric treatment. Here in the West, we say somebody's sick, when we really mean he's mad, or when we really mean he cannot face the stresses of the community in which he lives. And it seems to me that in some ways what's happened is that we have, in our desire to fragment and analyze and subdivide, we've lost the picture of the whole human being, in a sense, and arrived at the point where instead of attacking the cause, you attack the effect. Instead of attacking and looking at the social causes of what's happening to a person, you tend to say, I'll just give him to an expert called a doctor, and then forget him. And then the doctor becomes, as it were, paramount in that circumstance.
That does raise an interesting paradox. In the 18th century, if the patient recovered, it was probably for psychosomatic reasons. Now, in modern medicine, we have the patient on a slide or the patient in a computer, but we're relatively inattentive to psychosomatic factors.
Well, I think medicine, a lot of medicine is beginning to move back in that direction of so-called holistic medicine, medicine that takes into account a great deal more than what's on the slide. So in a strange sense, maybe we'll The more we learn about how the body functions, how the interaction of the brain with the physical structure of the body interaction happens, perhaps the more we are being attracted further and further back to the model that we left behind before clinical medicine began in France in 1810, 1820.
That's a very interesting answer. Well, that's fascinating and infuriating. You're saying on the one hand that Western culture today is for the most part materialistic, that religion is perhaps, relatively speaking, a thing of the past. But do you mean to suggest that because we're both materialistic and optimistic, commies and capitalists are the same?
In the most general sense of the word, yes, I suppose, because we both believe that society can be perfected, can make progress, and progress as a word really doesn't have much meaning before Darwin. So in that sense, we both believe in progress.
Well, I said infuriating because I'd like to put in a word for the cowboys. It does seem to me that in America, post-Darwinian America, social Darwinism, at least conservative social Darwinism, was not really so predominant. There were liberal Darwinians like Lester Ward and Henry George. There were later muckrakers and progressives. There were even philanthropic robber barons.
Well, yeah, I mean, about the philanthropic robber barons, people like Carnegie said, you know, liberty, inequality, survival of the fittest, is at the basis of good competitive business. And he said, I'm going to make my money and then I'm going to benefact the world. And P.S., I will not give it to any government to do. I'll do it. Rockefeller said, a great beautiful rose is only what it is because all the buds have been snipped away, and that kind of the weak shall go to the wall should be at the basis of good business. I don't believe that life was, you know, remotely as goody-goody as you're suggesting. That was a whole generation of businessmen founding their businesses in a rapidly expanding community in a country that had been founded on the basis of the least possible interference by the government. So, I mean, I think that for at least a generation, they took to it like a duck to water.
I really don't think it was all goody-goody, and I would point out that Andrew Carnegie was a Scot.
Oh, touche.
And I recognize that there were television necessities that make a good story.
That's an interesting point, actually, because George Bernard Shaw said, Darwin had the good luck to please anybody with an axe to grind. And when I saw that, I realized that I had found my way to end the program, because the trouble with Darwin is that everybody thinks they know all about Darwin, and they either disagree or agree with what they imagine the theory of evolution to be. And here was an opportunity to say, well, let me try and show the audience some surprising ways in which Darwin was misused. And that's as big a reason as any for why the program ends in that sort of triple manner.
You remind me, too, that some sort of evolutionary thought had been around, well, since the ancient Greeks, and certainly since Goethe and Erasmus Darwin and others, that the real innovation by Wallace and Darwin was a mechanism to account for evolutionary development.
Yeah, the funny thing is that it was called natural selection, and even the word selection suggests that there's some kind of purposeful thing, some decision being made there by maybe even the organism itself, that I will change to fit the environment better, when of course nothing was further from Darwin's mind. Well, relatively speaking, he regarded the thing much more accidentally than we sometimes think he did.
You don't mention Lamarck at all. And surely the reason for omitting him is related to this point.
Well, yes. I mean, the whole idea that organisms willed themselves to change. I mean, Darwin said, look, I believe there has to be some kind of cause behind it all. He did not believe in God. But he said, in detail, it appears to have no grand design, that everything seems to happen without an overall purpose. He went back and said, I'm sorry if I was too purposeful in my original book, he said.
One thing I have to ask you is about William Buckland, who, after all, taught several of the figures who turn up subsequently, Scrote and Lyell. Mm. When he eats the mouse on toast, what is the actor actually eating?
I'm glad you asked me that. Very important question. It was made of marzipan.
Well, I'm relieved to find the answer. Not that I was thinking of eating mice on toast myself. Well, James, I must say, fellow classmate though you are, you give our national hero, Thomas Edison, quite a drubbing. After all, he was played by Mickey Rooney on the screen. And
that's not fair of you. I didn't give him a drubbing. I could have mentioned Swan, who is reputed to have invented the electric light before he did. I could have, in terms of American heroes, I could have talked about Wheatstone instead of Morse. I actually did talk about Hughes inventing radio instead of Hertz. I mean, there's a lot of pluses in there. What I was getting at with Edison was that inventing the business of inventing, he spurred the modern world towards separating itself from science and understanding science as technology. And what I'm getting at there is that what people stop doing is being aware of the fundamental problems being faced by science and of the direction in which theoretical science is going. Because they say, well, we leave that to the scientists, that's theoretical stuff, and we're only concerned with the comfort-making appliances of science.
In the early Renaissance, when people like Toscanelli apply technology to navigation, that's seen as a very positive thing. Why should the divorce between technology and science seem
be a bad thing now?
Today? Why is it a bad thing now?
Well, I think because science is doing things that ultimately impact a great deal harder on us, impact in the sense of atomic bomb impact. I mean, you know, it's all very well to say all I want is a digital watch when the same investigation of the electron leads you to blow Hiroshima to smithereens. What I'm saying here is that we've reached a stage where the community has to be more aware of what science is doing. Back in Toscanelli's day, it sort of didn't matter. There wasn't much that was going to do harm to many people in terms of science, scientific theory then. Now there is.
I do see your point that the people of Nagasaki or Hiroshima were living in a Newtonian world and suddenly had Einstein's world dumped on them. In practical terms, obviously, we live our everyday lives still in Newton's universe. Could it be otherwise?
Well, I mean, the business about Heisenberg is that although Heisenberg is only talking about little teeny subatomic particles when he says you can tell where it is and how it's going, but not both, and therefore now we know we shall never know. We only live in a universe of probabilities, of chance, of God throwing dice, if you like. At the macroscopic level, it's true that if I hit myself, I'm solid, I'm not buzzing electrons. That's true in that sense. But in a much wider sense, what I was getting at was that Heisenberg also said something which works in the macroscopic level. He said, you can never separate the observer from the observation, that in observing nature, we change it. And what I'm trying to say in the next and last program is very much that if you look at the way in which we approach nature, in which we approach trying to understand how the universe functions, we arrive with preconceptions, with pre-structured views, with theories that we then test out. I mean, fundamentally, I suppose what I'm saying is that science is like a person going into a room with an electric torch. They point the torch into the darkness, A, because they have a theory there's something there to see.
This is a flashlight, a torch.
A flashlight, sorry. There's something there to see. B, that what is there will be illuminated by light, and C, that it is in that dark room. Well, that presupposes that there's something there, that it will react to light, and that it isn't in some other room. So before you get there, you've already pre-structured what it is you're expecting to see. And in that sense, Heisenberg is right. In ordinary life, we do everything. In doing what we do, we prejudge what the world is about. In observing, we change it. We fit it to what our expectations are. And in that sense, as I say, I hope to show in Program 10, scientists are no different from the rest of us, and that's why it matters that we don't care or take any account of what they're up to.
I suppose there is a danger. Okay, I understand the general point. To put it like a professor, science too is a culture-based activity. But what is the point of the Buddhist sequence near the end? That we should remain more open, pluralistic, less insistent on conformity?
Yes, it's part of that trap I talked about in Program 1. This trap set in Program 1 was to intimate that, you know, Buddhists didn't ask questions and they were dumb and stupid. And in fact, what I'm trying to do is to say, having been through the experience of the series, you recognize that people are constrained by the context in which they live to believe that what they believe is true and final, the only real answer ever found. And when you take that and look at, you say, science is like that, and then you look at other belief systems, the Buddhists, in their way, explain the universe entirely satisfactorily for the people who believe in them, as does science for us. So that's, yes, in other words, it was a plea for more open-mindedness on our part.
Well, Western science, I understand that our values affect how we interpret phenomena we observe, but isn't it true that Western science is in some sense incremental? How drastic are these revolutions that change the universe?
I think, first of all, that it's incremental, that it grows and grows and grows. It's a kind of rewrite of history that quite often you find in scientific books about their own activities. You know, people in the past were always aiming towards us. Anyway, if you look at most of the major theories, they were blown away. Copernicus. Before Copernicus, the sun went round the earth. After Copernicus, the earth went round the sun. I mean, how different can you get? That's not one thing building on another. It's one thing destroying another. And I think, except for technology, you know, building tables and chairs and bits and pieces, apart from that, what's happened has not been a steady accumulation, a steady move towards the final truth. No.
You use the space shuttle as an image of scientific achievement. In many minds, since that material was shot, the space shuttle, like Chernobyl, Three Mile Island, has become a symbol of a kind of overreaching, of scientific hubris.
Yes.
You hold out great hopes for the computer, but isn't it possible that that too is in some sense a naive expectation, that it can revolutionize human society, yes, reduce human waste?
There is one, it seems to me, one major difference, and that is that the computer is already in the hands of people. Once upon a time, 20 years ago, people said the computer will all be controlled by the computer because there'll be this massive mainframe brain somewhere, it'll run the world. You know, and look, everybody has one, everybody has something. Soon there will be people selling them information, knowledge, experience on discs, because the marketplace works like that. It's too late for society to be in the grip of the monster machine anymore, ever since the days of the personal computer began. So that's why I am optimistic about the effect of the computer on our society, because it, for the first time ever, those massive tools of science are actually in the hands of ordinary people to a great extent, in a way that makes it very difficult to control them. You can't, what are you going to do with all these people modem talking to each other? You can't come into the telephone lines and control.
But not too late in a place like the Soviet Union, where government control is a reality. And to go back to program number one, the NORAD sequence, Rome was overrun by barbarians. What's to keep that from happening to us?
I believe the awareness of the fact that other systems are neither right nor wrong. They are what they are. I mean, if we are to live, it seems to me we must coexist. That's why NORAD was an irony at the beginning of the series. To be so certain that you will destroy seems to me to be taking the wrongest possible road. And that's why this series has built, I hope, gradually towards an understanding that the only way to continue to exist safely is to be tolerant as possible.
You have a new educational model in mind.
Teach people to go looking for the material, and they'll discover that there are many different ways of seeing how the world operates, and that in turn, I think, will feed back into creating a safer world for everybody.
Sounds like your next series.
Hope so.